Hello, my name's Christopher. I'm something of a movie fanatic.
Hi, my name is Patrick, and I have a very short attention span.
In Must Watch Movies, a new podcast from the Zero Science Podcast Network, I'm going to try to put some culture into Patrick's trash brain.
In each installment, Christopher will choose a critically acclaimed film for me and my guest to watch for the very first time.
I'll open up each episode with why I selected the film in question, and what I hope Patrick and his guests will get out of it.
Meanwhile, my guest and I will attempt to give an objective take on a film that's been revered by many for years and years. So grab some popcorn and snuggle up on the couch while you listen to a Philistine stumble his way through some of the greatest works put to celluloid.
Coming in May, be sure to check out Must Watch Movies on the Zero Science Podcast Network or wherever you download podcasts.
Ugh, damn it, I burned the popcorn.
Hey guys, it's Lils. Just a heads up going into this episode. We recorded this a few days ago today with no initial problems, but when I went to edit this episode, entire portions of my audio track and mine alone glitched out, cutting out a few sections of the track. I've spliced it together into something listenable as best I can, and I apologize if you still hear any bits in this episode that sound off editing-wise. Thanks, guys. Iced coffee. Oh, I didn't see you there. Hello. Welcome to Jukebox Zeros.
Yeah.
Yes, the ceremonial jangling of our iced coffees.
Yes.
I'm Lil.
And Mountain Dew.
And I'm Patrick. Excuse me, I'm Patrick.
I'm Lil's. He's Patrick. And Mountain Dew, our third co-host.
Yes.
Big I'm ashamed. Soda.
Been there all the time since the beginning. We just never bothered to introduce him until now.
Well, that's where I threw Soft Shoe Magoo. That's what he's been encased in this whole time. And that's what Corey was drinking out of for a while.
Mm. Have you heard anything new from Corey lately since he up and abandoned us last time?
He's straight up left me on red.
Went to go hang with those Make It Stop guys for a little bit.
Oh, yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah, good for them for uncovering that classic record.
That's a quick plug, guys. Make It Stop finally covered Angelic to the Core. So if that episode's not out yet, be on the lookout for it.
At this point, it's like a rite of passage for every bad music podcast to cover that thing.
Sure. I don't know if that was a rule set in stone or anything like that, but I guess we're making the rules.
Nope, they are. They are now. We're on the vanguard, so we make the rules.
Oh, we're on the cusp. We're on the cusp as fuck.
Absolutely.
I don't even have a music podcast, and I covered Angelic to the Core myself.
Who said that?
The ghost.
Who's that?
Me, Shane Smith.
Oh, I was going to wait till after the apologies, but here's our special guest, an actor, a musician, an interesting music opinion guy, I believe I called him in our Twitter post. Shane Smith is here.
Yep, that's me. I am Shane Smith, and I'm a background actor, and I'm a musician that's not even that popular yet. In fact,
I tried to come up with some credits to, like, mention on the acting front. So I looked up IMDb and thought, surely I'll be able to find Shane Smith. And it was like, oh, there's more than 10 Shane Smiths.
Well, I can tell you this. I'm not the guy from Vice.
Oh, no. We wouldn't have that Shane Smith on. He probably smells.
Where are you streaming in from today?
Oh, I'm streaming from Oxford, Georgia in my bedroom.
Oh, wow.
Fantastic.
Nice. How's the weather?
Humid as hell.
Yeah, that's what I figured. Also,
yeah,
up
that's
here,
pretty much how it's going here too.
God damn,
yeah,
the Eastern,
like,
Seaboard.
Yesterday in particular, like, I saw a news story that said it was hotter in Maine than it was in Arizona as a high yesterday.
Oh yeah, Yeah, fuck the weather.
We're fucked.
That's fine.
Quite rightly so.
How about that apology section?
Yeah, here's the apology section.
Oh, jeez. Sorry.
So I've got a postscript apology for you that kind of ties into what Shane just said about Georgia. A while back, I said Todd, on one of our previous episodes, our good friend Todd Bowes, was one of the only people to have streamed in from another state. And I completely forgot about our good friend Austin from Sacramento.
Yeah, I thought about that immediately.
And I feel like a bit of a dubus for that. So, sorry. Sorry, Austin.
I mean, maybe he's just such a honorary guest that just an honorary entity that, like, we didn't even need to acknowledge him. It just understood that he's part of
he's
part of the DNA at this point. It's just being implied.
Have you got anything you want to apologize for, Pat?
No. I apologize for not being angry enough at all the shit that's going on. I'm pretty angry, but I could be angrier. And I will be.
It sounds like you're just sort of teeing us up to get into talking about this album.
That would be a much more delightful topic, I think.
Okay. Should I get into it with my little introductory essay?
You know what to do. Put the little ball on the tee and hit it. I think.
Let's mini golf this shit.
Yeah.
Okay. 70s band Aerosmith has been a staple of so-called classic rock music for decades, initially hitting it big with a distinct style of rock that was influenced by acts like the Yardbirds and Led Zeppelin, but mixed with the developing harder rock style of the time, a style that was driven by guitarist Joe Perry's blues influence playing and frontman Steven Tyler's notable charisma and distinct vocal rasp. It was incredibly lucrative as well, netting millions of records sold for the group, multiple top 40 hits, and a reputation as one of the hardest partying acts of the decade. Aerosmith would reach a period of languish during the 1980s, however, during which the band's drug usage managed to reach a fever pitch, which caused their album sales and live shows to suffer a little bit. By the latter half of the decade, however, the band... via dogged pursuit of sobriety, early pioneering of music videos for rock acts, and a famed collaboration with Run DMC that I'm sure we're familiar with, they pretty much managed to turn everything around. These positive fortunes continued into the 1990s for Aerosmith, whom it could be argued transitioned into the decade a little more smoothly than many of their contemporaries did commercially. They continued to sell many records in the millions, released Billboard-charting singles, received Grammy nominations, and gradually drifted further into merchandising, which would lead to accusations from fans of selling out. Then, as the decade wore on, a speed bump came of sorts. Their 12th studio album, 1997's Nine Lives, was plagued with production issues ranging from delayed release dates, internal struggles among the bands and their management, and drummer Joey Kramer's own struggles with depression, various troubled factors which led to a release that contained several successful singles, but sold comparatively less than previous records and left critics largely disinterested in what they deemed a pretty uninventive record, one that was very clearly gunning for mainstream success at the expense of Aerosmith's identity. And that's what we're doing today. This album was called Nine Lives. It was released in 1997, and we're going to listen to it.
I like kitties.
I, too, like kitties. Kitties are nice.
Oh, yeah. I used to own cats. Or rather, my brother and my sister did, so...
That's your connection to cats. So, yeah, quick round the horn. How does everyone feel about cats?
I also have a copy of this album with the original movie cover.
Really?
Yep.
Oh, here we go.
Yeah. As some little, like, behind-the-scenes stuff, you specifically picked this album, and in our group chat, you said, like you specifically picked this one so that you could play devil's advocate for it, because Pat and I are not big fans of Aerosmith, just on the whole. Like, I in particular I in particular am thoroughly repulsed by white guy party time bar blues music, and Aerosmith is like considered one of the foremost practitioners of it, of this kind of music as far as classic rock acts go. Oh, there it is. There's this, and it's got the original cover even.
Yep.
Now
that controversial thing that we'll get into later.
To piggyback off what you were saying, Lils, it's true. I don't love Aerosmith, and they do annoy me quite a bit. There's a lot about them that piss me off, and I've physically encountered Joey Kramer and Steven Tyler in real life before. I used to work at the Whole Foods down in Hingham, Mass, which is kind of near Joey Kramer's place down in Marshfield.
Steven Tyler and Joey Kramer were there?
Yeah. Yeah, they lived down in like the Marshfield kind of South Shore Cohasset area, in the richer parts. But yeah, I would see Joey Kramer and his wife on like a weekly basis. He was kind of grumpy, which now kind of makes sense, all things considered. Right. But yeah, anyway, tying off of that, all that being said, there's actually some songs of theirs that I cherish and think are like pretty important to the history of rock. I'm like a rock historian. I'm like a rock history nerd. So like there's just some shit that I consider important because I think it like helped, you know, progress the genres in some ways. There are some like, you know, really brilliantly produced records in the mid 70s at a time when like Zeppelin and the Stones weren't really doing anything in the mid 70s. They kind of came in and picked up the slack in a lot of ways. I guess I don't really hate them that much. I've sadly had to kind of come to admit that I don't hate them. So you might be on your own here, Lils.
What are your thoughts on Aerosmith, Shane?
Oh, I got into them largely because of my mom. She and my dad used to like order a bunch of stuff from Columbia House, and they just order like some of the most random stuff. Like, I swear to God, I found a copy of The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway in their CD collection, and
wow.
They hadn't even listened to it, and
I mean, who has time to?
I do. But
I'm just kidding. I love that record.
Yeah, but like, you know, like one day I came home from school and she had this album out by this band called Aerosmith. It's called Little Self of Sanity, and it's my introduction to them. And it's a live album, just a lot of stuff from the Get a Grip and Nine Lives tour. And I just got into them, like, ever since I was a kid, I've just kind of fallen in love with this band. For about 4 years, I did not really like them, because one time I saw a music video for one of their songs, and Steven Tyler did not have shoes on, so I'm like, oh, that's not good.
And that was your breaking point.
And also because people were starting to pick on me for liking the hard rock band from the 70s, so I figured I might as well switch over to Green Day, which was good because American Idiot like came out a couple of years after. And I started listening to more alternative rock, started realizing that there was a bigger world out there than just the Bad Boys from Boston themselves. And back in high school, I got back into them, and I figured, well, if I like this music, I like this music. If I don't, I don't. And
right
I
on,
still
brother.
Like them.
Right on.
And I have to agree with Patrick here. The 70s stuff is just so much better than the than like a lot of the 80s, 90s, and like 2000s stuff. Rox is probably my selection for best Aerosmith. Rox,
that would be my
line.
Pick too. Yeah, Rox is great. Really, really cool production all over that record, and like kind of unexpected shit that you wouldn't expect.
Oh, not just that, but it's like one of their darkest albums, and
yeah,
especially knowing what Steven Tyler and Joe Perry were doing at that time, it's like, yep, that sounds about right.
yeah, you do get a real sense of like what's going on in the studio. All over.
Oh, not just that, but I can believe that those lyrics were written by a man who asked a 15-year-old's parents to live with her. I could believe that those lyrics came out of a man who asked the parents of a 15-year-old if she could live with him.
Jesus. Well, this is going to be a very awkward episode for me then.
Yes.
I'm immediately predicting this, like, this is just going to be a rousing discussion between Pat and Shane just being like, oh, the production quality on the drums and these syncopation right here, and I'm just off in the corner going, I'm grumpy.
Well, Fret, you nuts.
Everything, like, your reasons for hating on Aerosmith are like, 100% fair, and, like, if I wasn't, like... I don't know. I was exposed to this music at an early age, and like my brother owned Get a Grip on cassette, and in some ways they were like kind of the first rock band. They kind of introduced rock exceptionalism to me, which I in some ways I guess was a mistake, because it kind of took me away from like I was like originally into pop music when I was like really young, and then like they kind of brought me and we'd be like, no, you have to be a rocker now.
For me, in some aspects, it doesn't just, you know, extend to the material. Because for the longest time, I just sort of thought of Aerosmith, oh, Aerosmith, whatever, they're not for me. Like, I don't think I really started to viscerally loathe Aerosmith, both until, like, I worked in a classic rock station for a while, and it soured my taste for classic rock in general. But also, like, as I got further into local music, because Aerosmith started out as a Boston band, and as they got more successful, I feel like they were very quick to dismiss themselves of that label, even though, like, the Boston press continues to fawn over them and do things like close off an entire section of Lansdowne Street while also shutting down basement venues and closing independent venues. Like, fuck all these independent groups. We need to make room for Aerosmith to charge, like, $200 a head and then promptly skedaddle back to Los Angeles.
Yeah,
so, like,
seriously.
just sum it all up real quick. What I'm saying is, if this episode gets us Road Rat 15'd again, I'm sorry, okay? I'm sorry.
I haven't checked up on our YouTube channel in a while.
Oh, that wasn't a YouTube quote. That was posted on our Apple Podcasts account.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
I think it's the one-star review we have on there.
Idiot.
Yeah. Anyway, let's get into the record, shall we?
Yeah, let's do it.
We're going to start things off with track number one, the title track, titled Nine Lives. In a week, the funk was all around. So this was the first single off the record, released in 1997 as a promo to rock radio. It didn't leave a huge impact, especially compared to the other singles on Nine Lives. It did manage to reach number 37 on the mainstream rock charts, though, so, you know, Billboard charting is nothing to turn your nose up at. And it ended up being the opener on the band's tour, which we'll talk about a little bit later.
So I actually do remember this being a single, because I was this was around the time, 97, that I was listening to WAAF. Which is like the local, I guess, hard rock station.
Yeah, hard rock and metal.
Yeah, like they're hard rock and metal, while BCN kind of handled more of like alternative rock. But yeah, they were playing. I remember them debuting this song when it came out, and they kept it going for a little while. But then actually, the next track on the record ended up being the more popular single.
Has anybody, like, noticed that, like, at the beginning of this song, Steven's just, like, constantly screeching like a cat?
Oh,
God,
boy.
Yeah,
I have some things to say about that. The Wikipedia article on this, a major note of the page is that after all the song credits, the author is very particular to mention the song starts with Tyler imitating a cat's wail, which whoever wrote that article is probably putting it pretty... like, take these. He took some liberties. Here's a clip. Just as a little inside baseball stuff right here, in my clips, I labeled this one Horrible Cat.
God, I kind of thought that was a decent screech.
I mean, it's stupid, but
for a man of his age to do something that high-pitched is kind of you know,
it's heading into Brian Johnson territory.
It's stupid, but like Pat said, it's stupid, but it's confident. Like, it sets a lot of the tone for the record, and it's like, it's just one of those things that's like that I like about it. It's like listening to that, like, bits of studio dialogue that happens on the Beach Boys Here Today, where Brian's where some of the session musicians are talking about some cameras that they're using, and Brian's like, "Oh, shut up, please shut up, no talking." It's during like that surf guitar intro. They're not like surf guitar instrumental, and it's like, and to confess something, I might have been the guy that wrote in the cat's wail part on that Wikipedia article. I used to edit Wikipedia back in the day, and there was nothing.
We
about
have a friend who does
day.
That a lot.
Our friend Christopher Brown has been on a real editing jag with the Phantom Gourmet for a while, and rightly so.
Yeah, absolutely. Fuck that guy. So, this song...
Before we get off the cat wail, though, like I was just going to say, I don't know about you guys, but listening to it, and especially compared to other stuff we've listened to, it kind of gave me weird, immediate PTSD flashbacks to this. Yeah! Yep, surf still up, school still out. Queen with Paul Rogers.
Oh God! Oh God!
Remember that? is that coming back to you yet, Pat?
Oh God, that record was bad.
Yeah, that was pretty atrocious.
That just sounds like a really bad version of that one intro to that Brainiac song. I can't remember what it was. It's off of their first album. But the guy's like,
oh boy.
He has it like fed through a ring mod.
Ew, that sounds like a terrible idea. So we get like a chorus in this song that's like, I don't know, like pseudo Middle Eastern or something. Was that like them trying to do something?
What I took away from it is
like, this is what Velvet Revolver tried to do much later, basically. It just sounds like a very early Velvet Revolver type song, except Steven Tyler's on it.
Yeah.
That's fair.
Yeah, I was about to say, like, it's like a hard rock band trying to do alternative rock, like, trying to, like, tap in that sort of, like, feel of, like, mid-late 90s alternative rock, and... That's what it really just, you know, that's what I kind of like about it. It just doesn't really feel like get a grip or pump or anything like that from the get-go. It just tries to do its own thing, even if it has Steven Tyler screeching like a cat and talking about sex.
I mean, that sexy times is not novel territory for Mr. Tyler.
He's pushing 50.
Yeah, seriously, he has grandkids at this point by 97. The alternative rock leanings is kind of a good point, because you get you did have like bands like Alice in Chains and Soundgarden kind of doing those like pseudo Middle Eastern riffs. So I could see them kind of like trying to pull from that to like, you know, add a little edge to like their rock sound a little bit.
Oh, and not just that, but there's this big rise in like psychedelic influence in alternative rock. Bands like Tripping Daisy, Smashing Pumpkins,
yeah,
even like bands like Walt Meek and Yeah, like Walt Meek and hell, even like parts of Eve 6 around this time, just like a lot of these bands are just taking on more and more psychedelic influence, and you see a lot of it just kind of rubbing off on this, on Aerosmith here. It's just from the opening track.
Yeah, here's the part where right, I contribute Lils, nothing to this conversation by saying I found the song just kind of really boring and generic. I mean, it's at best fine to me, and that's making me a little concerned that the whole album is just going to be another Be Here Now. Like, on the whole, not really objectionable, but just gets so long and overblown and, you know, set in its mediocrity to me that it becomes insufferable. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that's the charm of Be Here Now.
Oh, no.
Oh, we have another Be Here Now apologist. You and Sasser can go sit in the Be Here Now gulag. go to Here Now.
Yeah, be in jail now.
Here Now jail. Or whatever. Do not pass go.
Do not collect $200.
I guess I just wasn't seeing all these things that you guys are seeing, and I feel like that's going to be a recurring motif throughout this episode, which makes me a little nervous that it is just going to turn into you guys being like, well, this microphone, you could tell, and I'm just like, oh, I hate this. I want to go to Burger King.
I'm doing my best to not... I'm trying my best to be the mediator in all this, because all things considered,
you're clearly doing a better job than I am.
No, but like all things considered, there's a lot of doctoring all over this album, and probably a lot of A&R involvement. So there is, because of that, like you do, I think, kind of get rewarded with some strong hooks here and there. Despite what Stephen Thomas Erlewine said, I think there are some like decent hooks here and there. And on this track is kind of like a good example. I thought those like stupid choruses were pretty catchy. I'm trying to remember who helped doctor that one.
Marty Fredrickson, I think, because there's so many outside songwriters on this album. I'm looking at the back of my CD case and it's just so many of them.
This was actually the first Aerosmith album to not feature any songs written just by members of the band. It's all like Steven Tyler and Joe Perry plus these guys.
Well, they'd been working with Desmond Child since Permanent Vacation, I think. And they might have started bringing in other writers through the years. Oh, yeah, because Taylor Rhodes helped write Crying, of course, which he's on this record as well. But yeah, I could be mistaken, but this is probably like one of the first where it's like really, really like every single song is doctored by someone else, someone outside the band.
All right. Should we move into track number two, you think?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right. Here's track number two. One of the big singles off the record that once again, like you were saying, Pat, this was I too was getting into rock radio around the same time this record came out. I do not remember any of the singles on this album, but, you know, whatever. Here's track number two, titled Falling in Love is Hard on the Knees. So to once again tie it back into Be Here Now, even though the record kind of dropped off in CD sales after a while, it kind of really managed to, you know, go big with its singles. And this one was no slouch. It reached number one on the U.S. rock charts, number 35 on the Billboard Hot 100, and landed top 10 single slots in just a bunch of other countries.
Yeah, I was about to say, the clip that you just played is the Lil Self of Sanity version of the song.
Is it?
Yep. I remember that from my childhood on, like, van rides with my mom and dad. Just them arguing, and I just hear this.
No, you gotta take Route 11 to the old country buffet. No, you old dipshit, you gotta take old country road to the country buffet.
Wait, hang on, Pat. Are you positing that when Shane was but a wee lad, his parents were senior citizens in their 80s and 90s.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. They're elven folk.
I don't think that's what... Did you just say they're elven?
Yes.
They're elven, but talking like senior citizens at the ripe age of 80 and 90, which would have been, like, still baby age for elves.
Something like that. Or they're yetis. I don't know.
And, like... and speaking of, like, them just, like, playing the song in the car all the time, it's obvious that they didn't really care, like, what went into the song, because, like, I remember hearing in the song, it's like, oh my god, Steven Tyler is saying ass, he's saying fuck, he's, like, saying all the words. It's like...
Oh yeah, very important, your first swear
songs. He's saying the bad words.
Yeah, and...
He's going to do a swear right now.
Yeah, and...
Ahem.
Yeah, and...
Poopy.
That's really shocking, because, like... Aerosmith rarely, if ever, used profanity, like, on the 70s and 80s stuff. Like, the only moment that I could... Like, they used a lot of double entendre. Like, a lot of their songs from the 70s and 80s are about sex, but I only know one song from the 70s that actually uses profanity, and that's Nobody's Fault from Rocks, and it says, shit. That's all it says.
Yeah, but it's the 90s now. Profanity is totally the cool thing. It's the 90s. You gotta be grimdark and Rob Liefeld and things like that.
Now I'm just picturing that in that song, it's just like, I don't know, Brad Whitford, like, dropping something on his foot and going like, ah, shit, at the end of the song. Leave it in.
Yeah, maybe Gary Cherone's lucky songwriting pipe wrench must have found its way at Columbia.
Right on.
I like to imagine that people borrow his lucky songwriting pipe wrench all the time, but Gary Cherone's the only person who ever drops it.
Yeah, it's a Mike Post, Gary Cherone joint, exclusively.
Like, he keeps giving it to people to try to sabotage him. Like, yeah, go ahead. Be careful not to drop it. And then bring it back like, hey, thanks, Gary. This worked out really well. Ooh, what? But did you drop it? No, thanks for the warning.
So we get some classic 90s Aerosmith horns in this song.
Yeah. I actually kind of liked the horn section, and, like, I feel like a horn section is very difficult to do for, like, especially for, like, that specific kind of classic rock group, because it's very easy to just make them superfluous and just tack them on. But they sound really good here, and they're doing that very primal and simplistic da-na-na, da-na-na, da-na-na riff that sort of stuck pretty well.
Yeah, I think this is a good Aerosmith song, if that makes any sense. Doesn't necessarily mean I love it. It just, this is, it sounds like an Aerosmith song to me, and it does all the things that I expect from it, and they do it well. I don't mind this track. It's one that I do remember hearing a lot as a kid, but I haven't heard it in years. It was kind of like, oh yeah, this brings me back to, like, being in the car on my way to Cub Scouts with Dad, like.
Yeah, listening to Steven Tyler being unable to fuck people, just like on the way to elementary school.
Now, and son, this is talking about being on his knees because he's doing the lady from behind.
and not just that, but that when Lillian was talking about the horn section, she was like. I wanted to say that the horn section reminded me, like, a bit of Chicago and Ides of March, and like Santana, like just somebody smashed Vehicle and Smooth featuring Rob Thomas together.
Oh yeah, I guess it was a little pre-Smooth, wasn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, we can only assume the temperature that day. It might not have been a hot one. No, we're just gonna let that one marinate. Okay. So what keeps this one from being a solid like for me and keeps it stuck in the territory of, yeah, it's not terrible, I guess, is the lyrics more than anything. And that's, you know, going to sabotage it all for me because, like, I just generally don't like Steven Tyler both as a singer and a lyricist. And I feel like here he's still in, like, I'm horny and it's the 70s mode. And now he's, like, 40 and haggard from drugs and stuff like that, and he has a fucking sandpaper rasp. And he's still singing about how his libido has been blowing a transistor, and all I could think of is, yes, this is exactly the kind of music I want to just sort of slither into my barbecue.
Yeah, I mean, this is music for the divorced 50-year-olds who hang out at your local bar.
It hasn't aged very well, is what I'm saying.
No.
Oh, no. Yeah, it's a product of its time, but it's like it's a nice little product of its time. It's like listening to The Production Job on 10 by Pearl Jam. It's just one, like, you could tell it is early 90s, everything's washed out in reverb, but it's like, I like going back to that world. I like listening to a guy going on a shooting rampage because he found out that his mom raped him. Not really, yeah, that's what Once is about.
No, I believe you.
There's a lot of tough subject matter on that record.
That just took a bit of a turn, is all I'm saying. So Falling in Love Is Hard on the Knees was one of a few songs off Nine Lives to have been co-written by Glenn Ballard, who also produced Alanis Morissette's Jagged Little Pill and the soundtrack to Titan A.E., which is an interesting career path. He was the original producer of the record and completed an entire 9-song album with the band that was rejected by Columbia Records. This ended up delaying the album's release for an entire year, during which Aerosmith fired their longtime manager Tim Collins, which we'll talk about a little later, and they brought in-house producer Kevin Shirley on board to rebuild the record from the ground up. So that's a little bit of inside baseball history for you.
Oh, Kevin Shirley, the guy that produced Silverchair's first album.
Yeah, that Kevin
interesting.
Shirley.
Nice tie-in there. So I'm sorry if I missed this. So did any of those 9 tracks end up on this album, or they were all rejected?
This one, and I believe Pink, is also a Glenn Ballard track. There might have been one more. I can't remember which one it is.
Oh, right. Okay. Now I get it.
So for me, this is a song where, in spite of my stating there were things about it to like, still just kind of averages out to it's fine for me. Just don't read the lyrics.
Yeah, that's fair.
Well, just don't read the lyrics of any Aerosmith song outside of Nobody's Fault.
No, don't do that. Just listen to those smooth transients and those nice warm compressors.
Oh, and not...
Yeah.
oh, it's still pretty impressive that, like, Steven still has that, like, vocal range that he has in the 70s. Like, yeah, like you said, there's more grit to his voice, but he's still hitting the notes that he still can. Hell, like, even before the thing that ruined all our lives took root in March, you know, when they were doing shows over at the Luxor over in Vegas, Tyler was still hitting every note on his mark. Like he's still impressive.
I actually do I saw him at the he sang at the Grammys this past year, doing the, yeah, it was them and Run DMC doing their like fucking big thing on stage. But yeah, he was still hitting the notes. Okay, he's still
so you
decent.
didn't see him then? You saw him on TV?
Yes, I saw him on television.
You can't say you saw him right after you previously said you saw him at Whole Foods.
I can't. You're right. I saw a virtual version of him on my television screen, and I mean, unless they were piping in some sort of Melodyne thing or whatever that like live version of that software is. He sounded decent.
Here's track number 3. This one's entitled Hole in My Soul. There's nothing there, girl, yeah, I swear. Have the power ballad.
Sweet Desmond Child chord progression.
Ah, nice.
God.
Ah, nice. I love Permanent Vacation.
I tried so hard not to let my distaste for Aerosmith cloud my critical judgment when writing my notes, but we're at the power ballad now, this early in the record. The first of many power ballads. This was another single off the record. As we mentioned, a collaboration between Aerosmith and Desmond Child, who also co-wrote Crazy, another really annoying Aerosmith power ballad. And it was a minor hit for Aerosmith, number 51 on the Billboard Hot 100, number 4 on the mainstream rock charts. I don't like this song. I'll just say it up front.
I like it kind of in a guilty pleasure way. Like every time I listen to this album, and I've listened to this album about 10 or 15 times all the way through, and this album always slows down the album like it, you know, like they could have done without this song. But it's like if they accidentally wrote a post grunge power ballad, like it, mainly largely because of that like compression on the drums and again, like, the way that the Desmond Child chord progression is just kind of, like, messed around with. So it just kind of sounds like something that, like, Dishwalla would create, like a slower version of Counting Blue Cars.
Yeah, I mean, I could definitely hear that maybe in the production, but the, yeah, the song itself was, like, yeah, it had some interesting turns in terms of, like, the context of power balladry, which, like, Desmond Child is a, you know, he's a very accomplished songwriter, and he's definitely written better songs with the band. Yeah, I didn't hate this one, though, but I think choosing it as track three was a mistake. I think it totally killed the momentum.
For me, what kind of sticks out is that it feels like a very unnecessary amalgam of just previously successful Aerosmith songs.
Sure.
Like, there's elements of Dream On and Cryin' and Angel and a bunch of different power ballads, really, just all kind of mushed together into something that's got a lot less personality and is 6 minutes long, which it absolutely did
like
not
need
Joe
to cartoon
be.
Like one of those Joe cartoon in a blender cartoons.
Gotta love those early Flash
cartoons. Also worth mentioning, at this point in the timeline of Aerosmith's history, we are but 1 year away from the arrival of what is arguably one of the most ridiculous Aerosmith songs of all time. Don't Want to Miss a Thing from the Armageddon soundtrack. Future reissues of Nine Lives would include Don't Want to Miss a Thing on the track list. And, like, listening to this back-to-back with that really drives home the notion to me of, like, okay, Bad Boys of Boston, we want a song kind of like Hole in My Soul, but just, like, just really, really covered in cheese.
I'm gonna commit my musical sin here.
Get Diane Warren on the horn.
Yeah,
yeah.
Get the Unbreak My Heart lady on the phone.
How can I live without you by Leanne Rimes?
Oh God.
oh yeah.
Yeah, some serious.
I'm gonna commit my musical sin here, but I actually really love I Don't Want to Miss a Thing. It's a lot better than Hole in My Soul. Like, it's just more sure, and it's corniness, and it's, like, bombacity. It's just there. It's like...
Now that song I hate.
And also, it also kind of helps if listen to it in the context of Saints Row 4.
Here's track number 4, titled A Taste of India. According to stories, Steven Tyler came up with this song after he saw an Indian restaurant bearing the same name, which honestly really feels like the right level of intellectual curiosity for Steven Tyler. And reading the lyrics, it's a little more than just... Reading the lyrics, it's little more than another let's go do a fuck song with just kind of ham-handed references to Vindaloo and Tantris.
It's like if he watched like one Bollywood movie, just heard the music from it and sent it to his co-writer Glenn Ballard, and he's like,
"Oh, there's another Glenn Ballard."
And
one right
he's
there.
Like, "Yeah, make a song out of this. I want it to sound exactly like Mother India. I want it to sound like a Satyajit Ray film. But like, I want it to be sexy. I want it to give me an erection."
Is that how he says erection?
Maybe.
Erection. He tried Vindaloo for the first time and was just like, yes!
He just got a frozen food, Indian food, warmed it up in the microwave, and it's like, yep, that's my new song idea.
He had food court Indian food. While also having Sparrow at the same time.
I thought it was pronounced Sparrow.
What are these little Hot Pocket things that I'm having with my authentic New York-style slice? Those are panthras, Steve. Panthras. Write a song about it!
So this song kind of... starts to lean into like Metallica Load territory for me in some ways. That being said, I thought this track fucking rules.
Oh, that. Oh, it is tight.
I don't want to give the song too much credit because, like, it is, like, very appropriative and like, definitely a little ham-fisted here and there. But, like, the fucking, like, bass and drum groove that happens is that dook-dook-dook-dook. I can't get enough of that, though. And, like, the fucking Paul Mute, it's so good. It's so fucking clutch. And, like, it's well done and well produced. And, like, it almost makes me forget how silly and stupid the whole song is because it's just, like, I don't know. It's pretty well crafted, but that's the extent at which I think I'm going to memorialize this song. I'm going to let Lils tear into it.
Well, I was just going to say, to this song's credit, they did go to the effort of getting a legit for realsy Indian musician to perform authentic sarangi on the song. So might as well give him a shout out. That would be Ramesh Mishra, who primarily performed Indian classical music, but was also a pupil of Ravi Shankar. And this is another one that I don't want to say like, but also much like Falling in Love is Hard on the Knees. It's kind of, yeah, okay, this one isn't quite so terrible. But, and like, I'm very quick to needle a track for a superfluous string section where I can, and here it's actually used, like, sparingly enough to, like, good effect. It's not overused. It's pretty much used to build up the big rock ending and punctuate Joe Perry's guitar soloing after the primary verses are complete. It felt like a pretty nice touch.
Oh, and not cool. Just that, but the way that the strings are mixed into the song, it makes it sound like it's a sample from an old Bollywood movie.
Oh yeah, they used like the hot, like the mid pass filter on it to kind of give it that like vinyl touch to it. Yeah, I could see that.
There is kind of an awkward connection to Indian iconography that's attached to the record beyond like, you know, the sound as well. The cover that most people are familiar with, the one that, yep, that one right there. Well, no, that's the original cover. The one people are most familiar with featured a half-man, half-cat stuck to a knife thrower's wheel, was actually the replacement for another cover, the one that Shane has, which depicted a different cat person, one with weirdly horny curves and supple breasts, dancing on a snake demon, which was kind of like a takeoff on a similar painting that's really famous in Hindu iconography of Krishna dancing on the poisonous Naga Kaliya. The Hindu community was not on board with it, and future pressings of the record removed the offending cover in favor of the circus wheel one.
Yeah, I don't blame them. It's not my favorite album cover.
Yeah, we get like a Rex cat with his big old muscles.
A Rex cat? I thought it looked more like a sphinx.
I thought it was a hairless
kind of tomato.
I thought it was a
Hairless Rex or yeah, it could be a sphinx.
Yeah, they're both hairless cats.
Yeah, they got those big ass ears. Mm. Anyway, next song.
Right.
Welcome back to Cat Chat.
Track number 5, this one called Full Circle. So, if Wikipedia is to be gleaned from, this was also one that was released as a single, but there's no chart information on it, so I'm guessing it didn't chart in a major way at all. And like,
I don't remember this one at all.
Really? Because I feel like you were kind of alluding to it in our initial group chat, because this is one co-written by Taylor Rhodes.
Yeah. So, when I heard it, I thought I had recognized it, but yeah, it just really sounds a lot like Crazy or one of the other songs that they did together. It's that same sort of like 6/8 ballad.
Yeah, co-written by Taylor Rhodes, who also has a long history of collaborating with Aerosmith, also co-wrote Cryin' off their 93 album Get a Grip. And like, as we mentioned before, lots of songwriters on this record. And as I mentioned earlier, it's the first Aerosmith record not to have any songs written explicitly by the band themselves, just them and ringers.
With Full Circle, like the way that I think about it, it's like it's one of those songs I kind of wish weren't on the album, but at the same time, I don't hate it either. It's like that's a good little side cleanser. Also, if you listen to it in its double vinyl configuration, I think Music on Vinyl did a recent repress of it, or Legacy, or one of those labels.
Yeah, I think it starts off side two.
Yeah,
right. Yeah.
Hmm. I mean, just to be perfectly clear, there are very few, like, there's only a few songs that I outright hate on this album. Most of them are just sort of like, yeah, this is on it, like, inconsequential to me. But I tend to think that, like, songs with like albums with song with a glut of songs that don't really leave any sort of impression on me tend to make me angrier than ones that are just outright bad, because there's so much less for me to talk about.
Sure. That's fair.
But then again, it sounds like I wasn't trying if you two are finding so much to talk about.
I didn't love this song. It felt like a rehash of previous Rhodes collaborations. It's a little bit too long. It's like 5 minutes. Feel like it could have been trimmed down to like 3.5.
To once again tie this into Oasis for me, this felt like Aerosmith trying to write a champagne supernova, except much less interesting. Like, it ended up being if a band bereft of personality like Train tried to write a champagne supernova or something like that.
Yeah, I actually, that comparison would be good for one of the later songs for me, which I mean, I guess
it definitely feels like a track that has all the hallmarks of an attempted sing-along. And while I'm sure there are Tyler and Perry diehards out there that are going to get their lighters out for this one, it really doesn't have enough interesting things going for it to separate it for me from any other professional songwriting emphasizing pop ballad. Like, it's lacking a real hook, and it's got all the depth of a high school class song.
Yeah, it's just, to me, it's just kind of an inoffensive drinking song. Just there. And when something's just there, it's like, there's nothing interesting about it. At least Corey Feldman wasn't just there. At least he's all over the all over the albums.
There was no dearth of things to talk about with Angelic to the Core.
Oh, God. Yeah, we had to do it over two episodes.
Yeah. Just since I mentioned it real quick, go around the horn. What was your high school class songs?
So I was class of 2003. I want to say it was, I want to say it was Good Riddance, Time of Your Life.
Oh, that's such a high school class song.
Yeah,
right,
and it's such a stupid one too, because it's a fucking kiss off song. But like, whatever, it's stupid.
I was class of 2006, and I like to share this. I like to share this story wherever I can because it really was like an early example of me being snarky and stuff like that. Our class song, like, they set up a ballot between, like, that people could. Like, they the school had their choices, and we were allowed to submit our choices. And the final ballot, which included songs like Simple Man by Lynyrd Skynyrd and I Hope You Dance and just a whole bunch of other cliche class songs, and the whole, like, or at least a very large portion of the student body went, nope, and wrote in Sandstorm by Darude. And that won. That was our class song.
Oh, my God.
That's incredible.
They had to play that at graduation.
God.
That's incredible. Populism works, everyone. That's great.
Yep.
I don't know what my class song was, but I know what it was in my head. It was probably You Do Right by Can, but I don't know what the entire class of 2010 song was. It certainly as hell wasn't Full Circle. It was probably something like Defying Gravity from Wicked or something.
Oh, boy.
Like the musical?
Yeah, you know, that song from Adele Dazeem.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, I don't know.
Let's move on to track number six. Track number six, this one titled Something's Gotta Give. You know, it's funny, like, I always manage to find the most inconsequential parts of songs that I fixate on. This is how the song opened, with this crazy feedback loop, and I think this is so good. Like, I love that tiny little portion of it. Like, it could have totally been, like, sampled into, like, some second-tier 90s industrial act, like Stabbing Westward or Chem Lab or something, and it has no impact on the song whatsoever.
I believe it kind of does, because, you know, it leads in that whole sort of industrial rock meets cyberpunk blues aesthetic that Something's Gotta Give is about.
Is that what you took away from it? Because it did, like, I did not get industrial from it at all. Like, I got all the ham-fisted cyberpunk. Like, how about I just play a clip from how the song actually goes? Like, that was the intro. Here's how Something's Gotta Give for the majority of it goes. And I'm gonna break. Something gotta give. Yeah, it's just more fast Velvet Revolver bar blues. Again,
but the thing is,
to eat.
Yeah, but the thing is, it's like, you know, combined with that like harmonica and the Tom's low bass and like Joe just playing kind of lower on his guitar, like just lower on the fretboard. It just kind of sounds like, yeah, like you said, it is kind of like Velvet Revolver, but at the same time, it's like. It really has that industrial quality to it, like
it might be kind of like
skater punk made by like 50-year-olds. I don't know.
Oi, Patrick!
What the?
Billy Idol, is that what? You?
Let me in!
I heard you were
talking about cyberpunks.
Okay.
This is Billy Idol.
It's because we mentioned cyberpunk. Now Billy Idol is here.
I'm here to discuss your matter. So I think the faith problem with I don't know why I sound like an old Jewish man now.
Billy Idol, you are not invited to this thing. You got
it. I think what he's trying to say is that there weren't enough floppy disks.
Also, you're breaking quarantine, Billy. You got to get out of here.
I'm British. I don't believe in the quarantine. It's fine. Did Aerosmith did they use floppy disks at all? When they
No, Billy, they didn't have any fucking floppy disks.
I don't think they used floppy disks.
Well, that's the first problem. That's your first problem. It's not cyberpunk unless there are floppy disks. That's rule number one. Rule number two. Did he do a really shitty cover of a Velvet Underground song?
I don't think so. I forget. Is there a Here Comes My Man cover?
There's no Velvet Underground songs that they turned into a fucking Lords of Acid song on here.
All right. Billy, you can go now.
All right. I'm satisfied.
Bye, Billy.
What a strange thing.
Okay.
But yeah, as we mentioned, this is technically their cyberpunk song, if the lyrics are anything to be gleaned from. Here's some choice excerpts. Cyberotic head explode, information overload, and I just can't take anymore, and I'm gonna break. Also, if love that seemed to fall your grace was sitting on your interface, and megahertz she can't forgive, your love it died before you ever lived. Robot rock, robot rock.
Oh, it's like the toy dolls trying to write an entire song about upgrading their computer. One more megabyte. Yeah, it's fucking one more megabyte by the toy dolls.
Hey guys, robot cummies.
Damn it, Patrick. We went so long without you saying anything about cummies. So this one, co-written by Marty Fredrickson, who also co-wrote Nine Lives earlier in the record. Notable not just for having written other songs for Aerosmith, but famously performed the lead vocals for Stillwater, the fictitious band from Cameron Crowe's film Almost Famous. He also wrote some pretty big hits for a lot of big names like Carrie Underwood, Sheryl Crow, Gavin Rossdale, as well as a lot of inconsequential white bros like Default, Brother Kane, Cinder Road, and Bo Bice. So that's fun.
Bo Bice.
Oh, I wonder if one of his Default songs was Wasting My Time.
Oh, God.
I don't know. Maybe.
Man. What better name for that band than to just call themselves Default? Like, might as well just call it, like, Gray Thing. Occupant.
Male Preset 1.
Yes.
Unknown artist.
Oh, man.
Rock/pop. It's yet another track that'll be difficult to point out in a lineup a few days after listening for me, beyond maybe just the one with all the harmonica and Christendom in it.
It's kind of peppy.
Boy, they They love their harmonica on this one.
I'm gonna honk on Bobo. This one was a little peppy, so that's like about all I remember about it, though. That it had some pep to it. I guess Joey Kramer wasn't grumpy that day.
This is gonna make me sound like such a fucking curmudgeon, but I think I have in my notes my favorite thing is that it's mercifully short.
That's fair.
I'm such a dick this episode.
No, seriously, it's fine. It's really fine. Aerosmith deserve like they deserve all the derision that they can because they are a very celebrated band.
Well, I mean, we eventually like get tracks that are like 8 minutes and 56 seconds long, so I don't know. I'm just trying to think of things to say at this point.
True. Why don't we move on to the next one?
All right. Yeah, track number 7, titled Ain't That a Bitch. Speaking of going full Brian Johnson.
Oh, yeah.
You heard that chorus, right?
This is another Desmond Child penned track. Sadly, I found myself kind of liking this one, too, just because of I thought it was like, okay, I mean, the lyrics are stupid as fuck. Absolutely. I think Tyler is responsible for all the lyrics on this album, right? Like, I don't think they doctored. Did they have doctors on the lyrics, too? I'm not really sure if they just handled, like, arrangements and songs or if they were also, like, helping with lyrics, too. Anyone know?
I think it's usually kind of a collaboration. Like, I've heard, you know, tales about, like, how Deuces Are Wild was written by the song doctor, but also written by
Tyler. Yeah, there's probably some, collaborative input there. So yeah, I take the lyrics away. I thought the song itself was like pretty, like well done, like song doctor pop rock, I guess, for what it is. Yeah, I don't know. I saw the song title and I thought it was going to be like way cornier than it was. It's still pretty corny, but I didn't hate it.
I actually kind of like this one. It's like it's like, again, you know, kind of your usual Aerosmith power ballad, that sort of Desmond Child sort of thing, but it's like, because of that, like, opening, that it kind of sounds like they thought, hey, let's go mix a Roxy music, like an Avalon-era Roxy music song, but, like, mix it with an Aerosmith power ballad. It's like they're somehow creating art rock without really knowing how to create art rock. It's like Aerosmith are engaging in the same processes of outsider music without, well, actually being insiders to this whole thing.
I mean, there's some kind of, you know, overlap between, you know, what, you know, art rockers were listening to and also these, you know, these sort of pop, like power pop songwriters too. Cause they, you know, at the end of the day, they're both acts are trying to find like build on strong hooks. Art pop, I should say, not art rock, but like they're still, you know, trying to build on a foundation of like heavy pop hooks and like, you know, strong song craft. So yeah, I could see, you know, some of that happening. See where you're coming from a little bit.
The vibe that I personally got from it is similar to the one that I got from Full Circle, since you mentioned that earlier, in that it's clearly trying very hard to be a big sing-along or possibly end credits music, but I just didn't find anything interesting about it beyond that, unless you're like a big fan of Steven Tyler's crazy goblin voice, which I am not.
I kind of wish that Steven Tyler, whenever he said, you don't give a hump, I wish he just went
there. Yeah, that first verse line, when you're down on your luck and you don't give a huh. Has that non-swear fake-out ever been clever in rock music? Like, particularly in a song already titled Ain't That a Bitch?
One of my favorites is the Heart of Rock and Roll, where fucking Huey Lewis...
I was just thinking of that
really
one.
...really kicks you in the... instead of the ass. They couldn't say ass.
Ass barely qualifies as a swear anyway.
Yeah, but people were weird in the 80s.
Maybe it did in the 80s,
people were weird in the 80s. Like, they were... Yeah, they were kind of uppity about that stuff, so it was like, that probably saved them from it, you know, not getting played on certain radio stations in the Midwest that were, you know, a little more scared of saying ass. Not us Bostonians, though. Right. We sing about asses. Don't we, Steven Tyler?
Wow! Yeah.
Excuse me? I think he's hungry.
That beloved Boston song, Sweet Caroline, with that chorus that goes, Sweet Caroline ass.
That Sweet Caroline ass.
So I have very little to say about this song, so I'm just going to talk a little bit more about the behind-the-scenes stories that surrounded this album. The aforementioned label issues we mentioned earlier undoubtedly put Aerosmith in a rough spot, but the band's own interpersonal issues came into play a lot as well. Steven Tyler was taking a lot of heat from tabloids who were accusing him of cheating on his wife at the time, and Joey Kramer had to exit the band temporarily due to depression. Most monumentously, though, the band decided they needed to fire Tim Collins, who was their longtime manager and helped mastermind Aerosmith's comeback in the 80s. Collins, the band would accuse of in various autobiographies, was an obsessively controlling manager who would manipulate the members against each other to maintain his grip on power. The worst of it, according to Joe Perry's autobiography, was when Collins supposedly sent spies to Steven Tyler's 12-step program meetings to accuse him of relapsing. They were on the verge of breaking up over Collins' overreach when the band fired him in 96.
Yeesh. Yeah, that's rough. And, you know, that's tying into a very dark side of the music industry that doesn't often get touched upon, but, you know, when I do bring it up, it doesn't make me very popular at parties. But yeah, just it sucks, you know, that there are these toxic individuals in places of power that just, you know, that they manipulate, you know, people who are obviously, you know, at this point, like, you know, very kind of mentally weak and dependent on, you know, help, outside help and shit like that. And they have a history of, you know, being at odds with each other. So, like, you know, just using that history against them. And, yeah, just fucked up, you know, and in turn makes them into toxic individuals, which, yeah, it's just they become victims and, you know, abusers all at once. Yeah, it just sucks ass. Anyway, this song, I forget what song we're doing.
Ain't that a bitch?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, this song's fine. Let's move on.
All right. Moving on to track number 8, this one titled The Farm. Okay, surfs are still up and school is still out. Let's get... All right.
You might be in your little dog, too.
Uh-oh. I think we broke Pat. And now he's what? Some kind of pigeon, it sounds like.
Okay.
Here's the actual track. Here's The Farm.
And I feel like New York City. Get me to the farm. Get me to the farm. Get me to the farm. Somebody get me to the farm.
This one featuring a co-writing credit from Mark Hudson, who has also been a longtime collaborator with Aerosmith, also having written their big 93 hit Living on the Edge, as well as doing songwriting for Ringo Starr, Scorpions, Hanson, and Baha Men. Hey, we were just talking about them in the before times. Oh, also credited is a guy by the name of Steve Dudas, who does not have a Wikipedia page.
Wow. That Baha Men episode seems like it was centuries ago. God damn. So, wait, did he collaborate on a song on the album that we did, by any chance?
I don't know. And
I'm going to look that up.
Yeah, you do that. So, real talk, going into this, the moment I see the title The Farm, I start thinking to myself, this is their country song, isn't it? Because up to this point, there's just been like so much cavalier experimentation going on, the dipping into punk, Indian music, and champagne supernovas. I mean, it's laudable for trying so many different things, but I personally feel like very few of them have stuck the landing. So you can imagine how shook I was to hear something legit different that I thought actually sounded pretty all right. to the point that I'm surprised that this wasn't a single.
Oh, I'm shocked too. Like, it sounds like a really good Screaming Trees song, and like one of my only sore spots about the song, and this is kind of a minor thing, but one of my only sore spots is the gratuitous Wizard of Oz.
Yeah, that seemed kind of superfluous, and it also extended the song to like, you know, to the point where it was a lot longer than it. Like, if it ended, if it took the samples out, it would have ended around like the 3:45-ish mark, and then it would have been like, you know, just good. You know, it would have been really good, but then it just kind of drags on a little bit.
Okay, sorry. Big ass news. So, Mark Hudson,
cool,
helped pen You All That on the Baha Men album. If you remember that
what?
One. He did Summer
Wait a
of
minute.
Love. Desmond Child helped write You Can Get It.
All these yeah. connections coming out
yeah,
of the woodwork.
There too. Yeah.
Are you...
Yep. Yeah. Holy shit.
Were the Baha yeah, Men in the same studio as the Aerosmiths when they
it's
wrote
much,
this when they wrote this album?
They very well... it was a couple years away. Probably not, but... man, that's too much. Yeah, I kind of like this song, and it makes sense that he also helped write Living on the Edge, because it kind of has that same swagger to it.
Baha Men were just down the hall and hearing Steven Tyler going, wah! And they thought, let's not do that.
we need to do another take, because Steven Tyler's voice just like went through three layers of Rockwell foam.
Steven Tyler's voice traveled through
Steven walls. Tyler's yeah. voice is the only thing that can be heard through vacuum.
Oh, yeah. It's
Steven Tyler's voice exists in a black hole. But yeah, I'm kind of surprised this wasn't a single, like, because it's so different in a good way. Like, the lyrics are a lot more abstract and stream of consciousness than, you know, all the other Let's Do a Fuck tracks. And there's, like, kind of a neat dissonant thing going on with a guitar. And once again, another brass section that doesn't feel tacked on.
Yeah, not bad. Not a bad track. Yeah, exactly. You're expecting much worse with a song title like that. It's still pretty silly. I think that's the extent of which I can talk about this song.
Track number 9. Here's track number 9. This one titled Crash. Aerosmith does skate punk,
yep,
I suppose.
That's what I wrote.
Or maybe it's their take on Van. Or maybe it's their take on Van Halen. Or maybe it's their attempt at a Stone Cold Crazy. I don't know.
That too. That was my favorite part at the end, where he just fucking goes off like a house goblin who just got freed. like he just fucking like popped out his box of mozzarella sticks, and they're in the oven, and he's getting ready to go.
Yes, Steven
doing a little jaunty jig.
Yes, for his goblin sticks.
Yeah, Steven just like he just like goes all off, and he just goes so intense that he devolves into his first form, which is a harmonica solo.
Oh my god, you're right, actually. So funny.
So if this is, in fact, Aerosmith's take on punk rock, I would have to say it lands a lot more gracefully than previous fast ones like Nine Lives and Something's Gotta Give. Like, it's got a better, much more raucous energy to it than the aforementioned blues rock but fast tracks. But if it is Aerosmith trying to do punk, it kind of misses, like, one of the key components of punk, which is brevity. Because this is a pretty long-ass track, and it kind of drags for a while, because it feels like it runs out of ideas for
me. I don't know.
Yeah, 4.5 minutes is a bit long for a punk rock track. I'll attest to that.
After a while, you just end up with many minutes of just Tyler doing the little goblin scaring. Because he's so happy for those goblin sticks.
Yes.
It should be on a Tony Hawk's Pro Skater soundtrack. I could see myself grinding some rails at the Slam City Jam to this.
Yeah,
collecting VHS tapes.
Yep, just to see Bam Margera hit his groin on a rail.
Yeah, this one.
That's
was
what
kind
Bam
of...
Margera's famous for, yes. Right? Hitting his groin on things.
Yep.
Yeah, just placing his groin where it oughtn't be.
Oh yeah, and also
Bam Margera. That's not where groin go. Put that away.
Also, having way too many Italian sports cars and somehow destroying him every time that he's on MTV.
Oh boy.
Anyway,
I thought this one was kind of fun. Sorry,
I was just saying I thought this one was kind of fun, despite the length. That was my thought on it.
Yeah, this one's another Mark Hudson co-penned one, so maybe there's something to this guy because all of his songs have kind of like, for me at least, they've sort of been approaching like all the ones that have his stamp on them.
I actually not
quite there yet, but. Yeah.
Oh, you're right. He does. And Dominic Miller. That was the other guy who I don't know who the fuck that is. Argentinian-born guitarist who spent much of his career as a sideman for Sting. Nice.
Yep. Interesting career path.
Yeah.
Should we move on to track number 10?
Let's do it.
All right. Track number 10, titled Kiss Your Past Goodbye.
Love you lost, we're all in vain. The past lives on. Memories hanging round. Yeah.
Goodbye. Cool. Another dirty word fake out. So cheeky.
It's not a dirty word fake out because he actually, at the last refrain, he says, "I'll kiss your ass goodbye."
Okay, yay! That's true. So many of the more negative reviews for Nine Lives often threw around the term calculated, as we mentioned, when talking about the professional songwriter heaviness of this record. And tracks like this really just sort of drive that home to me. Like, for me at least. Like, if you remove Steven Tyler's distinct bridge troll gutterings from the occasion entirely from the song, like, I feel like there's very little to separate it from a song by just any other generic pop-focused rock group. Like, this track feels like so many others on Nine Lives, it could easily pass for a single by some band or artist who you hear all the time on soft rock radio and you're sure gets someone excited, but you have no idea why. It's like a song by, like, Andy Grammer or The Script or Chris Allen or someone like that.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Those are all fair points. That being said, I did kind of enjoy this song because there was actually some cool progressions happening like with the root notes. Sorry,
you guys are killing me.
Sorry. I don't know what to tell you. it is another fucking ballad, yeah. And of course, we all hate ballads because we want to rock.
I liked it.
Me too, buddy. Me too.
Yeah.
Well, like, that calculatedness, I feel like, is a recurring problem with Nine Lives just on the whole, because, like, for every Taste of India or The Farm where they're just actively trying to do something different, there's just so many more songs that are so professionally primed and polished that they just lack any sort of identity. And yes, I've mentioned multiple times earlier I don't like Aerosmith, but I'm not going to deny that they had a distinct sound, and it's not really being utilized so much here. But, I mean, that could also be said of any of, you know, Aerosmith's, you know, deeper attempts at pop music, you know?
Yeah, sure. No, that's all fair. All the points
and,
you're
and
making
maybe
are
it also speaks
fair.
To, like, what a wide net of influence Aerosmith had over the years, or maybe it was just kind of ahead of its time. But in any case, it just makes it difficult to find anything interesting to talk about, for me at least.
Yeah, Aerosmith kind of came in. It was always just, like, a matter of good timing with them. I think that was like a big part of their success. Like I said, in their first run, they kind of like swooped in at a time when like other hard rock bands from across the pond were kind of starting to falter a bit, like Rolling Stones and Zeppelin. Zeppelin was like mostly absent in the mid 70s. After they put out Physical Graffiti, they kind of disappeared for a while, up until they did Presence. So yeah, they kind of like, They came in, you know, right in the middle of the decade when, you know, at that time. And then, you know, they fucked around too much with drugs, and then they were like, I'm baby, I can't write song anymore. So they fucking started... well, yeah, I guess they did that Run DMC thing. That was like their big comeback in the 80s, right? So it was like...
Yeah.
So yeah, it was them like actually being mindful of a like a current musical trend and like actually utilizing it to help them like become more successful. But then like I don't know. I'm going way too much into my final thoughts at this point, so we should probably move on. We're at the last few tracks now, right?
Yeah, we've only got like three more tracks from here.
All right. Well, let's do them up.
Okay, track number 11. This one people will probably recognize. Track number 11 titled Pink.
Pink, it's the color of passion. Calls a day, it just goes with a fashion. Pink, it was love at first sight. Yeah, pink, when I turn out the light.
This one, the biggest single off the record, even bigger than Falling in Love is Hard on the Knees. It reached number 27 on the Billboard Hot 100, topped the mainstream rock charts for 4 weeks. I do not remember it.
I remember it. I still remember it to this very day.
That's crazy. You couldn't escape this song for a little bit. This is kind of like a weird sleeper hit from this album, too, because this album came out in 97, and I feel like... I remember hearing a lot of this song when I was in eighth and ninth grade, which would have been like 98, 99. So yeah, it was like a good like year or two after the album came out that this song like really kind of picked up momentum. It stinks. Which is funny because it's called Pink Stink. That being said, there's some clever songwriting happening here and there. I just wish it wasn't this song. I wish it wasn't in Aerosmith's Pink.
I thought that song was actually pretty charming at first, and then I think... I thought it was like, okay, you know, it's a clever way of trying to talk about how much he loves this woman, but the more and more I listen to it, especially on my recent re-listens and, you know, concurrent with me finally binging through Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt on Netflix, I realized it's just Boobs in California by Titus. It's this song where... It's this openly gay dude just singing about how great boobs are. That's the only thing he sings about in the song.
Well, yeah, because this song is not about a woman. It's very clearly about vaginas.
Yes. Yeah, like, yeah, absolutely.
Not even like, all the ladies. It's about vaginas.
Yeah, exactly. I'm trying to remember who helped write this one.
This one is another Glenn Ballard one. Also included a man by the name of Richard Supa, who was very briefly the guitarist for Aerosmith when Joe Perry temporarily quit in 79, and would later go on to co-write a lot of other Aerosmith tracks, as well as tracks for Richie Sambora, Micah, and funnily enough, Pink, the pop star.
Mr. Ballard.
Hey, how do you do that?
Mr. Ballard. Mr. Please call it Mr. Supa. I wish to pen a song about a vagina.
I feel like this is the accidental anthem of TERFs.
Oh, God, yeah. Whoops.
I could see that.
Jesus. Yeah, that's... It was the 90s, that's for sure. I feel like, by all accounts, I should hate this song. And on paper, I do hate this song. I enjoyed it more than I thought I would listening to it these past two times, and that's that's really embarrassing to say, but that music video is a goddamn catastrophe.
Let's talk about that music video.
Let's talk about it, because that's a problem.
I mean, on its face, it could be considered quite progressive. Like, it's against a black space. Stay with me here. against a blank slate of a backdrop. It's just this wide panoply of people just kind of strutting their stuff and looking sassy and sexy. And there's just such a wide range of people. There's like people of color, overweight individuals, elderly folks, drag performers, tattooed and bald women. Just a lot of people who would be characterized as non-normative by a much more unnuanced person. And it's not played for laughs or anything. They're just kind of strutting their stuff, and the video's just going like, look at all these sexy, sexy people.
Yeah, okay, that part is nice.
Then comes the band. It's interspersed with unsettling images of the band members' 90s CGI faces swapped onto random people, and it is...
Whew.
Peculiar. There's one way of putting it.
It is uncanny.
I have not seen the video in years, and it's still burned in my mind. I wish it weren't, but it's still burned in my mind. And I saw like all the 90s Aerosmith videos. I kind of wish that they just made another music video of Alicia Silverstone or something. Like going to see like the Vagina Monologues or something.
Oh man,
yeah, it's a weird contrast. There's like, here's a sexy person, here's a sexy person, here's Steven Tyler's face on the body of a small child with bunny ears. It's positively Lynchian.
Yeah, this video was cutting edge in the way that the dancing baby in the early 2000s was cutting edge. Your fucking crazy frog was cutting edge.
What about the Money for Nothing video?
Now that was
clips. Yeah, cutting edge in the sense that the clips of Dire Straits were in that bad FMV, like right. Super low frame rate quality,
yeah.
And all the CGI was blocky.
What I like the most about it is that they couldn't even be bothered to like animate the mouths of the block people moving. Like their form of communication is just blinking lights.
Have you guys ever seen the video for Let's Rock by Def Leppard?
No.
I think it came out. It's off the album that they did in 92. Oh, my God.
Is that
God.
Also a very bad, dated CGI sort of thing?
It's like yes. One of the best examples of horrible dated CGI I've ever seen. And like it goes along so well with the absolutely corny lyrics of the song. It's delightful. It's just
question.
Fucking corny and cheese in its greatest form. Yes.
Question. Better or worse CGI than the video for Bullets by Creed?
It's pretty close.
Because that just popped into my head.
It's pretty close.
And like, there's a weird, yeah. Creepy other layer to this video, too. Like, paired with the specific imagery and just how horny of a song it is, I just picture just like... Steven Tyler going like, produce me a montage of people, and just sitting by the fire with a snifter of brandy just going, I'm gonna fuck her, I'm gonna fuck her too, I'm gonna fuck him as well, oh, you know I'm gonna fuck them.
Ooh, yeah, look at that snack. Oh yeah, he's mine.
Yeah, I've heard like jokes about like Steven Tyler like having a lot of involvement in the casting for the like the 90s music videos. Like I heard jokes about the Crazy music video, which has his daughter Liv Tyler and some person,
Alicia Silverstone,
and Liv Tyler's character has to
both
Liv Tyler and Alicia Silverstone are in the video, and both of them are you know, do a little stripping contest, and Steven's probably just off stage. He's like, come on, strip for daddy, strip
yeah,
for daddy.
Oh my God, you know it.
Or he's
it's
just
terrible.
Sitting very just like intently watching, just like, yes, good, it's all coming together.
All things to say.
Mr. President. I want to call the Pink music video a like one of those bowling alley animations that play whenever you get a strike. But I realize that would probably apply to Patrick's other two examples.
Oh man!
But
those
if I had to
good.
Go into a bowling alley that played
and bullets,
if I had to go into a bowling alley that played that music video as a strike animation, and then actually played the entire music video, I would probably go. I would probably become insane that I would actually throw the ball at my own head.
Now that's a Lynchian concept. Just like You get a, like, the ball just rolls into the gutter, and here's a clip of Joe Perry as a centaur slowly walking towards the camera, and just very slowly the caption, gutter ball.
Fun fact, the Bullets music video was actually created on a Apple IIgs circa 1985, used specifically at Norwood Junior High School. No.
Really? Oh, boy. I just heard a clap of thunder outside. I think it's going to rain soon.
It's going to rain, finally. Jesus Christ.
In New England, anyway.
God, it, down in so. Georgia, it's sunny, but it's also, like, overcast.
Okay. Let's move on to track number 12. We're very close to the end here. Track number 12, this one titled Attitude Adjustment.
Lightning, thunder, and I keep wondering why. Hey, I think you need an attitude adjustment. Knock down, drag out. And I got to make myself an attitude adjustment.
It's the Aerosmith song that predates post-grunge new metal, I guess. I mean, did you guys get, like, a similar vibe at, like, that sort of riff at the beginning that just sounded like it's not Rage Against the Machine, but it wants very, very badly to be Rage Against the Machine that you've heard in, like, every nu metal track?
Oh, yeah. I put in my notes that Aerosmith do the entirety of alternative rock radio, and I also put down Aerosmith do Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Yeah, that's fair. I don't know. Go. Lils, why did you hate this song?
Ugh, same verses as before. Like, I feel like I've been painting myself into these corners more and more, but, like, these songs are just so bland and forgettable to me for the most part. And it's not even like every Aerosmith member is playing their parts perfectly fine. It's just, and, like, I'm not even, like, knocking professional songwriters or anything. I'm not going to be a fucking rock and roll purist about it. But this is a bad batch of songs, is what I'm saying. These are so uninspired and uninteresting. Maybe I'm cynical. I don't know.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Like, I thought this was Aerosmith's probably one of their more interesting things. And, like, Attitude Adjustment kind of, it's like, oh, man, that's actually kind of a good song. I actually like the fact that they're actively listening to alternative rock radio. And I'm going to go against, like, Patrick and you here. But I actually kind of like the co-writes with Marty Fredrickson. Like, I think they're probably some of the more fun co-writes. They're not as wildly experimental as Taste of Any Air at a Farm or as professional as the Desmond Child co-writes. But it's just... they're just, you know, like, you just have that, just, like, sense of vigor about that. It's, you know, fresh young blood for Aerosmith. They finally, can satisfy the elder gods. They can create great, like, good-sounding rock and roll that's actually kind of interesting, that actually piques my interest, that actually ties into a lot of my interests regarding 1990s alternative rock, and they're, like, playing Red Hot Chili Peppers, and finally Steven Tyler says, excuse a fucking moi, like, and I noticed that when I was a kid. It took me until, like, college to notice the use of the word fuck on Fallen in Love. But I noticed the use of the word fuck on Attitude Adjustment, and it's like, it actually kind of works. It's to me, it's just kind of a fun song. And I expect the same old Aerosmith lyrics. I just expect Steven Tyler to just write with his dick in his hand. But at the same time, it's like...
or with his dick.
Yeah, but at the same time, it's like, at least I know I'm getting something kind of interesting, like Joe's more sloppy blues playing and Brad Whitford's more assured ability to actually play the guitar. Like, you've seen that really messy performance of Dream On that they did, like, from the late 70s, where Joe keeps fucking up the guitar and they have to switch, like, Brad has to take over the lead part.
I haven't, but I've heard about it, yeah.
I mean, I guess that's, you know, where we sort of differ, because I know what I'm getting into with Aerosmith, and I already don't like it, and now on top of that, like, there's all this sort of trend hopping going on that I just feel like doesn't land. I don't know. I feel like the subtitle of this episode is going to be Everyone is a Jerk Except for Shane and also Patrick.
I, I was just gonna say this song is fine. I did kind of like the vocal hooks in general. I thought the I didn't think there was an absence of hooks on this record. I caught them. I'm someone who loves pop hooks anyway, and I you know, typically listening out for them. And there's something to the choruses of this one. But yeah, again, I'm going to save my final thoughts for the end.
Since I've got so little to say about this, I'm going to bring the whole behind the scenes discussion full circle reference and talk about the tour that followed Nine Lives' release, because it was notable for having its own set of problems behind the scenes. The tour was originally intended to be a shorter one, but ended up stretching from May of 1997 to July of 1999. The band was just about to go off tour when Don't Want to Miss a Thing hit the airwaves, and that encouraged the group to keep going for another year. The tour was financially successful, but as many as 43 shows had to be canceled and rescheduled due to accidents that happened to the band. Steven Tyler suffered a cruciate ligament injury after dropping a microphone stand on his knee. Several band members got into scheduling conflicts or caught the flu. And in one baffling incident, Joey Kramer suffered second-degree burns from a freak explosion at a gas station.
Damn.
Joey Kramer cannot get a break. Between this, the depression, and being shafted out of the band in the late 10s.
Yeah, you know? and being out of ground chicken that week. Yeah, it was that was a tough week for him.
We still don't know if he ever got his drumsticks back from Mrs. Krabappel.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Oh, thank goodness. That's really good.
As Simpsons writers, write a sequel to that episode like right now.
So one thing I want to point out that really stuck to me in looking up information about the Nine Lives tour, there was a very wide range of supporting acts that joined Aerosmith on the road. Some of them made a lot of sense. Lots of classic rock old guard acts, blues rockers who got a lot of influence from Aerosmith, or acts that were just really big on modern rock radio at the time. You got acts like Kenny Wayne Shepherd, The Black Crows, Pre-Racism Bryan Adams, Candlebox, Lenny Kravitz, Ministry, Space Hog. Wait.
Ministry?
This is true. I double-taked when I read that on the Nine Lives tour page on Wikipedia and had to learn more about industrial metal Uncle Al, who was perpetually face-deep in piles of drugs touring with recently clean bluesy butt rockers Aerosmith.
Oh, God, I hope when he did Jesus Built My Hot Rod, I hope he got Steven Tyler to do the goblin voice over a distorted amplifier.
Jesus Built My Hot Rod!
Got him to do the Gibby Haynes part? Unfortunately, I could find no information about it, just a lot of stories about how Steven Tyler is an ordained minister now. And funnily enough, a colorfully titled stoner rock tribute album titled Right in the Nuts. I'm not sure how that popped up, but that was in my search too.
Mm.
Yes, that is the thing.
Oh, I need a link to that as soon as we get done. Because
yeah, I'll link you the Wikipedia page.
I got to listen to this shit now.
All right, we're finally at the end here, so I can't get over Ministry touring with Aerosmith, no matter how hard I try. Specifically 90s era Ministry. Fucking Thieves and Liars Ministry.
I think Steven Tyler tried to get him to play something off with Sympathy. Hey, play She's Got a Cause. I like that one.
Oh, Steven, you make me so angry.
Yeah, but I actually like With Sympathy.
I like With Sympathy, too.
Okay.
Yeah, we're With Sympathy stands here.
We're pro With Sympathy.
Yay!
We just like razzing Uncle Al.
Everybody does. I mean, he wrote that a really weird political rock album not too long ago.
Right. Anyway, here's track number 13, Fallen Angels. This is just typical.
Yeah.
Like, I spend all this time griping about how there were so many songs bogged down with superfluous filler and ballads. And, like, the album just goes like, you want superfluous ballads? I'll fucking give you superfluous ballads.
Now,
here's
this,
8 minutes and 16 seconds worth of superfluous ballads.
This is our champagne supernova, I feel like.
Yeah. I mean, it's certainly no All Around the World to once again tie it into Be Here Now, but fuck.
Yeah, there's a whole lot of nothing that just happens like that last 4 minutes that kind of just like Gold Dust Woman's out at the end there for like way too long.
I agree. It's probably my least favorite song off of Nine Lives. It's just weak. It's like I never really thought it was that great of a closer. The only thing it's been good for is that it was in my ears when I was sleeping on the bus when we had our senior class trip to Disney World. So we could go see Paramore.
Oh, man, I'm so old. That's a nice story about being on the bus on a school trip and falling asleep. I have one where we our school did a trip to Branson, Missouri. That is a story for another day. To participate in a countrywide jazz band competition. But anyway, we had to take a bus.
The wheels on the bus go round and round, round and round, round and round. Round, round, and round, round, round. The wheels on the bus round, go. Round and round, round and round.
Anyway, so my quick story is we had to take bus from Branson back to Kansas City Airport, and I just woke up and puked my ass off like once we got to Kansas City. It was a lot of fun.
This song, I would argue we didn't need more than, say, 4 minutes of this song, this bland, smoothed-out, featureless, soft rock dentist room ballad.
Yeah, it's pretty indulgent at the end.
Much less another 4 minutes of aimless guitar feedback, atmosphere building, and more Steven Tyler's goblin scatting.
Oh, I wish that this track had the interesting qualities of Amazing. Because at least, like, Amazing had that, like, really cool guitar solo at the end. At least it had that music video. At least it had that Jump Blues sample where Steven Tyler's talking about the light at the end of the tunnel being with you or something.
All right, I don't have anything else to say. At this point, I just wanted the album to be over because it just turned into such a huge, tedious slog for me.
Yeah, let's get to our final thoughts.
Yep, final thoughts. Pat, do you consider this a worst of all time album?
It's funny, all right? I thought that I hated this record. I thought that I was going to hate this more than I did. And then, like, listening to it twice, I actually found things that I ended up liking about it. There's actually songs that I enjoyed, you know, from front to back. So it's not the worst album of all time. I don't even think it's the worst Aerosmith album of all time. I think, you know, Just Press Play, that was the next album that comes out, it is a lot weaker. And they had shitty outputs like in the late 70s and 80s, like, you know, Rock and a Hard Place, that like those are like really just like boring and uninspired to me. Like, at least this one has the benefit of like some strong songwriters coming in and kind of like you know, bolstering up you know, some of the more tired arrangements. That being said, it really says a lot that you know, it really says a lot about an album that, like, the thing that I'm enjoying most about it is the output from outside songwriters, which doesn't really say much about the band. So, like, can I really, like, judge this fairly on behalf of Aerosmith, or am I, you know, judging this more on, I feel like there was actually some successful, you know, work done between Kevin Shirley and Desmond and all these other song doctors that come
Steve
in.
Steve Dudas,
yes. Rest in peace, of course. I don't know if he's dead. So, yeah, it's just, this is a hard album to really rate because it's like, they're not really doing anything, I guess. I guess it's more of a triumph for the producer and the outside songwriters than it is for the band, which I guess I just, yeah, it kind of makes me lose a little respect for them in the end, in a lot of ways. But yeah, that's my final thought. It's not the worst, and it's not even their worst.
Same question to you, Shane. Do you consider this a worst of all time record?
Not in the slightest. I do have a little bit of a write-up about the album. It's probably one of the more odd albums in the Aerosmith discography, largely because of the expanded experimentation, but also because of the fact that it is them starting to embrace a lot of these outside songwriters a lot more. And it's like you get all these like different moods conveyed throughout the album, and I don't know whether or not I can call it a guilty pleasure or not, because like I don't believe in such thing as a guilty pleasure. I believe every album has its own qualities that are worth sharing. I mean, I like Alien Ant Farm's second major label album. A lot of people don't, but I like it. And I got trolled because I liked a band called Walt Mink. And but at the same time, it's Aerosmith. Like, I know that they have better music out there, and I know, like, in the sense of them trying to capture the essence of 90s alternative rock throughout this album, and I know in the sense of a comeback classic album from a classic rock band, you know, like Chicago had an attempted comeback album, Kiss had an attempted comeback album, Van Halen had Van Halen 3, whatever in the hell that was, Motley Crue, Poison, they had one. But, like, Aerosmith seems to be the only band that actually managed to do the comeback album somewhat correctly, because, to me, I just find it interesting. I find it really good music to put on during a car ride, or put on, like, just to listen to it, because, to me, it just feels like there's something else going on in it. But I know that in the context of that, of all these things that I mentioned, like, it's not one of the strongest Aerosmith albums. Like, it's not going to be, like, top 200 for me. It's not even, like, one of the strongest 90s alternative albums, or alternative tangent sort of albums. Like, one of the, like, anything kind of affiliated with that genre. Because there's a whole bunch of other bands that I wish would get their just due. Rather than just focusing entirely on Nirvana and Neutral Milk Hotel and Godspeed, why not, like, mention, like, Toadies, or Not a Surf, or, hell, Heat Miser, Elliott Smith's first band. Why not Shudder to Think? Hell, why not Stone Temple Pilots' first album? Or even mention, like, Eve Six's first album?
I will say that Tiny Music is one of my favorite albums of all time, and I do consider it to be one of the best of the 90s.
I do, too. I recently re-listened to it right before I did my Nine Lives binge again, and it's just, like, it really comes across as a really great album. Like, and a lot of people are like, oh, it's just weak, it's not as good as Purple, it's not as good as Core, it doesn't go as hard as Number Four. I'm like, yeah, but it's really interesting. It's like listening to, like listening to it again, and listening to the fact, you know, listening to how, like, Stone Temple Pilots combine all of these albums, combine all these, like, different styles, like, you know, combining lounge with alternative rock and shoegaze, and all these like throwaway things that people just wrote off as trends that should be forgotten. It kind of reminds me of what 100 Gex are doing right now.
All right, well, let's not get too much on a tangent here.
Yeah, but
now's probably a bad time to mention that I could not get into 100 Gex either.
I understand.
I still haven't listened.
I understand. Yeah, my final thoughts on Nine Lives is that Nine Lives is actually pretty good. I don't, you know, like, I wouldn't recommend it as anybody's first Aerosmith film, but if you don't like the band, then maybe you could give this one a shot. Yeah, you know, there's something in it for everybody.
As for me, I feel like I've made myself pretty clear throughout this entire podcast. And, like, clearly you guys all found something in it, but I could not. Like, I still don't get how this record has defenders. It's just so concerned with being a pop act and not being Aerosmith that anything that I might have, you know, gravitated towards, as few as they are with Aerosmith, is just gone for me. And, like, I tried. Like, I told myself, Lils, you're going to sit down and you're actually going to, you're not going to let your disgust for Aerosmith get in the way. Much like when we did Music from the Elder, because I hate Kiss too. And I found much more to like about Music from the Elder than this. I didn't end up liking it on the whole, but I found more to like about it, you know? Here, I just couldn't give it an inch or anything like that. Like, for every, like, there's just nothing here for me. For every, like, The Farm or A Taste of India, there's just so much generic songwriting and superfluous bloat. I just can't give it any more inches than that. Maybe it's because, like, I'm dead inside because the world is turning to dog shit and we've been cooped up so long, but I just can't. I simply cannot. And, like, in the end, for me, it doesn't even register so much as, like, I don't like it so much as it just registers nothing for me. Like, for all I've said about it, I can't even call it a worst of all time record. It's just vapid and unimpressive to me than straight up bad. And, like, that still means by no means it's not good, but as I mentioned, that tends to make me angrier than just straight-up bad records. I tried, but there's just nothing here for me.
Oh, there is one more track that I think
that killed the mood.
Yeah, there is one more track that I think you are missing. It is on vinyl copies and on overseas copies, but Joe Perry had a solo song fit right between Pink and Attitude Adjustment. It's called Falling Out, and it's straight up Teenage Fan Club. He wrote a Teenage Fan Club song. It's actually pretty good.
Okay, I'm going to say that I'll check it out. Anyway. Moving on from that, what would you say is the best or least bad track, Patrick?
I really liked Taste of India. It was corny and probably not like the most graceful track on the record. But yeah, that groove just, it fucking got to me. I remember when it was a single too, and I remember even liking it back then, and it was kind of fun to hear it again after all these years.
Same question for you, Shane. Best or least bad track?
The best track is... Falling in love, it you know, there's just a charm to it, like a guy admitting to his own sexual faults, a guy admitting to the fact that, you know, he's not going to be able to output as much as he could back in the day, and also the fact that he's again stumbled, yeah, you know, like the band's also stumbled upon this like alternative rock sound, and also I just have a lot of really nostalgic memories for this song. To me, it's just fun.
Mine, I'm going with The Farm for best/least bad track. Like, I'm not, like, for as much as I don't like this album, I'm not going to be one of those just like, there's no good tracks on here, sort of thing like that. What about worst track for you, Patrick? What was the worst track?
On paper, I want to say Pink because that song it just fucking sucks. but because I actually found myself liking it more this time, I'm actually gonna go with Fallen Angels, because it's just too fucking long and we didn't need another ballad, and it just, yeah, it didn't have, like, literally the only thing interesting about the song is that it's 8 minutes long. It's lacking the interest that some of the other ballads on the album have, and yeah, I very much wanted the album to be over at that point.
Same question for you, Shane. Worst track?
Fallen Angels. That's it. Fallen Angels.
Oof. We are in the hand-holding club here, then, so because I also pick Fallen Angels for the worst track. Hey, we finally found a consensus.
Yay!
Friendship.
You get three idiots in one room, and eventually they'll agree on something, right?
Oh, boy. This was a long one. But thank you again for joining us, Shane.
Oh.
I've been meaning to have you on the podcast for a while just because you've got such interesting music opinions. So thank you for popping in on this one.
Yeah, man. Thank you so much. This is great.
Oh, no problem. And don't forget to check out my stuff at clickerrecords@bandcamp.com. Clickerrecords.bandcamp.com. Clicker Records is one word.
Well, I was just about to ask if you had anything to plug, but clearly you beat me to it.
Oh, you can edit that later.
And see if you can find Shane on IMDb. You won't. have you got anything that you want to plug, Pat?
This time around? Nah, not this time around. I got some big music things coming up, but yeah, just stay tuned.
I'm going to plug, go check out the other Zero Science podcasts. Go check out Old Men Yell at Cloud, Clamshell Case Files, Nickelback In, your new podcast, Must Watch Movies, and my new other podcast, Hell is a Musical.
Thank you for plugging my podcasts.
Oh, boy, and that about does it. Our theme song is Sunny Day by the band Froggy and the Friendship. You can check them out at froggyandthefriendship.bandcamp.com. If you have an album you want to suggest for us to review or just want to leave us some feedback or a comment, email us at jukeboxzerospodcast@gmail.com. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/jukeboxzerospodcast or on Twitter at twitter.com/jukeboxzeros. You can find us, rate us, review us, and subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, and Spotify, or check out our archives on the Zero Science main page. Jukebox Zeros is a production of the Zero Science Network. For more great podcasts, go check out zero-science.com. And that about does it for this episode of Jukebox Zeros. I'm Lails.
And I'm Patrick.
And remember... Yeah! Oh, shit, wrong one. There we go. That's the one. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Zero Science.